Hi everyone, if you can take your seats for the next Salon discussion of the day here at Art Basel in Hong Kong. It's a real pleasure to be hosting this conversation alongside my co-moderator Vivienne Chow, founding director of the Cultural Journalism Campus and honorary lecturer at the Journalism and Media Studies Center at the University of Hong Kong. And the title of the talk is Does Political Art Matter? A discussion. And we'd really like to welcome our speakers today. We have with us Zhou Junfei, an artist and based in Hong Kong, Cosmin Costinas, executive director and curator of Parasite, Sampson Wong, artist and independent curator and lecturer at the Department of Liberal Art Studies, the Hong Kong Academy for Performing Arts, and Wen Yao, artist and researcher from Hong Kong as well. So, to begin, we thought it would be really nice just to start with a simple question to each of our panelists or our speakers, which is really for everyone to offer a definition or their thoughts on what actually makes a work political or what actually constitutes political art. So who would like to begin? Perhaps we can start with Fei.
Okay, because this time is short, so I will jump to the conclusion for myself that I don't really believe in political art. Well, especially I'm a painter, but people consider I am a painter, and when you start a painting or you try to use painting or some kind of art object to react to a political situation, it's always too slow, it's always... you have to be very direct, you have to be loud and clear, then somehow, as a painter, it is not very effective to make an object to react to a political situation. But that depends on how you define political art. That of course, you make an artwork, and you don't really have to consume your time to make an artwork, especially in this in today's contemporary art world. I don't mean making contemporary art doesn't consume time, but it really depends on how you define an art object or how you define a piece of art and how you define a political art. But I said that I tried to jump to conclusion for myself, but today I have three objects that help me to explain why I, as a painter, that I don't really believe in political art, but still, my artworks, it's always about the political situation today. I will explain with you with all this object later. Yeah.
Hello?
Yes.
Hi. I think maybe I'm in the opposite because I started as a performance artist, and then people always say, you, the naughty political artist. Because actually quite a lot of my work or even some other performance artist work are politically concerned. That means the content touch on politics. And for me, political means more than social politics, but also it involves gender politics, spatial politics, or even identity and all these issues, or even body politics when I do performance art. So actually my own experience is that actually I was not satisfied by only doing politically concerned art. That's why I try to do, like I try to make a change, and therefore I do some more so-called politically engaged art. Maybe we can talk more about this later.
I think it's very difficult for an art object to avoid a political significance at some point of its existence. And that's because art is too much of a complex phenomenon, too much of a complex formation that is embedded in so many of the realities and lives of its producers and its receivers that the politics of that society not to be part of the reception of the significance of that object. And I think in order to remind this of this fact, it's important to repeat that the politics of an art object also changes and art's meaning is also not fixed, and it's a constant process of negotiation at different phases of the art object in relation to the different agents that come into contact with it, from curators to audience members and so on, to the different institutions that mediate the life and the evolution of the meaning of art. And at some point in this circuit, in this trajectory of an art object, different political understandings and meanings of that art object will occur. And they might change, they might be different, but it's very difficult for this to be avoided. And the most, kind of subjective and depoliticized, let's say, you know, in its initial intentions, object might at some point become an important piece of a political narrative that tries to understand something and to say something about, you know, its creators, about the social group that created it, that received it, and so on and so forth.
Yeah, I mean, it just actually makes me think about artists who've always said that, you know, just to be an artist is political in its own right. But Sampson, I'm so curious to know your thoughts. I mean, how would you define political art?
Actually, I find the question really interesting because we never really ask, does sculpture matters, or does new media art matters, or does painting matters? We ask, does political art matters? Because it implies that we hope, we wish that political art matters. So in a way, in posing the question this way, we are endowing political art with some weight. We wish that it matters. But to me, perhaps I would try to be polemical here, making a statement that I believe that in order for political art to matter, we have to understand its potential in the fullest sense, in a sense that actually I'm training as a political scientist at first before I come to art. So I understand politics as a power relation. So if we understood art has the power to transform power relations, then political art matters. And this is my belief. And I, in particular, I think that art, political art matters when it increases the agency of everyone to believe that a status quo can be transformed. So that's my two cents.
So now I think we can have questions directing to each of our panelists. And since Sampson just spoke, so let's go back to Sampson. I know that you're working on something really interesting at the moment, that you're translating a booklet written by the curator of the Disobedient Object. So that was an exhibition stage at the V&A. So can you tell us how you got into this project and why you're doing it?
Yeah, sure. I got the luck to encounter Gavin, which is now a professor of art history at University of Exeter. Last year, through a forum initiated by the M+ Museum. It was about activist art and museology. And it happens that he was looking around for someone to translate a small pamphlet or a small book into Chinese, because that small handbook is already translated into 7 languages. And it can be downloaded freely online. So it's a small book called A Guide to Demanding the Impossible.
Why was it not translated into Chinese at the beginning? I mean, if it's already translated into seven languages.
I still find it, on the one hand, I guess he wants that book to be circulated in China or in the Chinese-speaking communities, but to me, I think my interest in translating that book is particularly answering the question, does political art matter? Because it argues that a certain form of activist art are what makes political art matter. So that's I've been interested in proposing that argument as well.
But it's also like it's like an exhibition study as well, right? Because you're translating a document about an exhibition that sort of, I'm talking about the disobedient objects one, but sort of riffing on what you're saying. So I'm really curious to know how, you know, you've worked with this exhibition history, because translating also creates this relationship to the objects, the stories around them. I wonder how, like, you see these documents of movements and how they sort of translate once they go into the museum space as well. So I guess it's a two-pronged question.
Actually, the book I'm translating is a project, a precursor of that exhibition. So in a way, the practice of the museum, at the V&A Museum at that time, and the exhibition itself is still exploring how we can adequately exhibit or re-narrating the activist practice that generates some of the ethos of political art. So I think it's actually quite controversial in how we can translate those practices into the gallery and museum context. But in a way, in highlighting there is a translation process, we also address the interesting phenomenon that we understood the first order or the first ground of emergence of political art is not in those, in the museological context.
Speaking about objects and how they represent certain movements or how they situate themselves within institutional frameworks, I mean, this might be an interesting time to bring in Cosmin, because, you know, on the one hand, we're thinking about exhibitions in which actual ephemera or items that were used in protests, we're thinking now also about exhibitions that can have a political potential. And of course, Cosmin, the work that you've done at Parasite has addressed some of these ideas, I think, and I'd really love to hear more about that. And of course, when we were preparing for this conversation, I did say that I was thinking a lot about a show that you did last year, actually, wasn't it? 2 years ago, wow, time flies. 100 Years of Shame, Songs of Resistance and Scenarios for Chinese Nations. So I wonder how you might relate to this, what we've just discussed, which is, you know, an object from a demonstration put into a museum, does that constitute a political, like an emergence of political art, as Sampson suggests? And then how does that, how would you respond as a curator working with art objects?
Well, that was a very interesting process of working on that exhibition, and you know, I somehow accepted your challenge of talking about that exhibition a little bit, because it was the most unpredictable of the exhibitions I think we've done at Parasite, at least in the last few years. The exhibition was co-curated with Anthony Young, it overlapped with a very important period in Hong Kong, because the show opened in early March 2015 and we've started working on it in the summer of 2014. So the moment we were actually talking intensively with the artists was the beginning of the Umbrella Revolution. So the object in front of us was shifting every day. Because the initial intention with the show was that of, you know, a rather intellectual exercise of exploring the sources, the imagination, the vocabulary, the images behind contemporary manifestations of Chinese nationalism. You know, to trying to look at, you know, the official history that justifies and builds Chinese nationalism, the kind of references that are used, the genealogy, and, you know, particularly from the perspective of art, and trying to use the tools available to exhibition making, to curate, to curating, and to art making primarily, to understand and to decode that formation. And, you know, that's an important exercise in it in itself, because going back to your initial question of like how, or I don't know if you asked how, but if we are to understand like how art matters politically, like very often it is as an intellectual exercise. It's about its ability to understand things differently, of saying things differently, of putting things in a different light, rather than achieving any kind of, you know, commensurable goal in the public arena. But that intellectual contribution is itself, you know, quite enough, actually, in many ways, if it actually manages to do that. So that was a little bit the horizon of our ambition. But as the political reality around us was shifting dramatically in September and October 2014, both on our side and also on the artist side, there was a very strong need to position oneself in a way around this subject. There was an uncomfortability for all of us to deal with this simply as an intellectual object. There was a certain need to take a position. So that was a very interesting process, not just for the exhibition itself and for the subject at hand, but about all these issues that we're discussing here, of like how does one ultimately, you know, chooses to engage with that subject, you know, to what extent one you know, needs to be fully in control of an intellectual narrative, to what extent, you know, this statement comes from somewhere else. And at the end, I think the exhibition was a hybrid, I think an interesting one. I don't know how successful, because it tried to do different things at the same time. But I think that hybridity and maybe that contradiction in a way expressed the confusion and the very particular energy of that moment as well.
Well, I think what's interesting actually is when I remember that show, I very much felt like it was a conversation. And I think that reminds me of, when you say it's an intellectual endeavor, I mean, of course, that always relates to the need to have conversations, right? Which I think, Sampson, you've spoken about before. But it's quite interesting at the time that you were mentioning, and this whole question of like how to respond to this situation that was constantly unfolding. I think when Yao and Sampson, you were both involved in kind of actually talking about how to preserve or archive some of the objects, which relates to that exhibition that you've been looking at the V&A. So when Yao, actually, I'm curious about how you see that process, and also like after listening to Cosmin and Sampson, you know, what is the difference between an object that manifests in a spontaneous moment and an object that is, you know, consciously produced in response within the context of art, actually. So in Parasite's case, an art space.
How can I turn it on? Yes, so not this one? No, it's okay. Just fast forward. So actually I was in this day last year on Fulbright scholarship, and I came across to see this very inspiring show in Brooklyn Museum, the Argyle Park. Basically, actually the curator has done some research and has invited so-called the first wave of a group of artists, activist artists, and then this first wave or the first group of artists will invite the second group of artists to join the exhibition. And then the second group will invite the third group of artists. So actually it's kind of very interesting process of like experimenting with curating the show. And also actually the objects that the artists have been using in the activist art. And I find some of the work, for example, the entity in inner noise. Actually, the one can be kind of like decontextualized when you put it in the museum. But then this loading one, actually, I found it very effective because actually kind of it has been decontextualized, but somehow when you put it back to the museum, it kind of like legitimized him as an activist and put the state there. So actually this inspired me a lot about like how the object of activist art can be preserved and how to continue or how to engage the dialogue in it. So for example, actually inspired by that, that project, the Argrid Port remind me of a project that I've done 10 years ago. It's called Talk Over Hanover. And that project was kind of like on the occasion of the 10th anniversary of Hanover. And at that time, I did some research, and then I invite artists who were active in the 1997 period to have a dialogue to, they can select an artist who were active in 2007 at the time. So after the dialogue, they produce a work, each of them produce a work to sort of to show their reflection after the dialogues. And this year, this is kind of like the 20th anniversary of the Hanover, and we'll do the 2.0, like Talk Over Hanover 2.0. So we try to open up the pauses, kind of like we did an online polling and call for topics that people feel like they're interested in at the moment. And then we do an open call for kind of like exhibition proposals. And then we will, in the process, before the exhibition, actually we will select the proposal and then we'll have public discussion on these topics. So our idea is actually we try to open up to have more dialogues instead of like putting all the things in the white cube in the gallery space. We try to open up to a process which engage more like the public, and also we try to create a critical dialogues on these topics and critical discourse in the process, rather than only having an exhibition showing all the artwork. Yeah.
I mean, well, that's kind of like a perfect transition to Fei.
I think engaging the public, I think that's a very important nature. I mean, that's what politics is all about. And I think for Fei, I think from being an artist to actually running an election campaign that you took part a few years ago, running for the Lashkol election. Just wonder how is that experience? I mean, for you, was it kind of like was it a transformation, or the whole act was in fact a performance?
It's just the leaflet that I have when I was running the election. You can see a younger me in this leaflet. Slimmer, yes. Okay. But
When was that again? Sorry.
It was 2011.
2012. So it's 5 years ago.
What? Oh, okay.
And what were you, could you like clarify for the audience though? What were you running for exactly? Okay. Like, what was the position you were campaigning?
Yeah, this is one of the objects that I have today that I just try to show. I'm trying to show you how artists are pushed to be political, like someone like me. I don't really believe in political art, but at the same time, my work is full of political statements. That all this love that for the promotion of the elections in the past few years, the one I have here is for the legislative council election, that there is a seat for culture. So this is what I have ran for 5 years ago, and this is another new candidate that ran for the same seat last year. But the one who won the election is this one. So, but you can see there are still many other leaflets like this. there is another election for the voters for the chief executive of Hong Kong, which can be very complicated for foreigners, that we have an election before the election of the CE in Hong Kong. And for the election, before the election, that we have seat for, we have representative from culture. That means this 15 guys, I'm one of the 50 guys here, that we ran for the election before the election last year also. So, but we all lose that. These are the 15 guys won the election, that they have lived in, together with the calendar. I mean, who will put your calendar in your wallet today? Obviously, the target audience is someone who never use smartphones and will keep their promotion leaflet inside the wallet. But anyway, this is what I'm trying to show you of one of the objects that actually we have so many political activities which is related to the cultural sector, like this one, the leaflet for the promoting the election, that you can see there's one representative dressed in the Cantonese opera costume. So let me have the other object that I want to show you that also shows the change of the political, of the politics in Hong Kong. This is a DVD that I collect 10 years ago in 2007, which is a promotion object, a promotion item for the West Kowloon Cultural District. To prepare for this talk, I watched the DVD again last night. Again, I can find a younger me in the DVD, but and I can also find many other designer, artists, architect, dancer. They were all inside the clips too. That at that time in 2007, I think even for an artist to help to promote the West Kowloon Cultural District, we don't think there will be any problem. But yeah, for today, if you talk about the West Kowloon Cultural District, that the recent news is that we are going to have the Palace Museum in this region, which the building of the Palace Museum was considered to be the one of the campaign of the CE election. I mean, the one of the campaign of Carrie Lam, who is running for the CE, which we are going to vote the day after tomorrow.
No, you are not.
I don't have to vote. So, yeah, so this is the other object. So, no matter for the election of the CE or for the election for all, before the election or for the cultural seat in the Legislative Council, they are all, artists are actually involved, but we are involved very passively. So I try to show the last object that I have today. This is all the signature that we collect on street. That we have a campaign about the to help the artists in factories. That in 2009, the Development Council tried to have the revitalizing factory project. That they said that all the factory or the industrial building was abandoned, so we should have better use of that piece of land. But actually, the whole program was to push up the price of the land, and now you can see that the some of the industrial region is being rebuilt into hotel and that kind of things. So we have the signature collected from the street. We have 4,000 signature, and actually this document was sent to Carrie Lam, who was the head of the Development Council. And that's how I start my second life in politics.
I think, let me, so for those who are not familiar with the political situation in Hong Kong, so what is happening right now is that this Sunday, there's an election of the chief executive in Hong Kong. And what Fai was referring to was that this election is it's in the hands of an election committee that consists of less than 2,000 people this year, and so Fai was running a campaign to become to get elected in the election committee, which will have the right to vote on Sunday's election. And to my knowledge, Sampson also ran an election for the election committee, but in a different sector. You're in the higher education, right? So how did your experience in running that campaign relate to Fai's stories?
It's very simple. The experience was very simple. It is that it's very difficult to make troubles. So if you want to make trouble, you have to be extremely creative, and at some point you have to, it is very powerful to employ the language of art to make trouble. So one of my Bible that I think about political art or activist art is a book called Beautiful Trouble. Actually, it suggests that making trouble could form something very beautiful on the way. So my original experience in participating in that election was to was hoping that if I can be part of the election committee, I can make some sort of creative troubles during the election. But it ends up you find that no one is buying into that idea. So that makes political art isn't quite easy, or isn't. You have to have a specific set of communication skills to convince people that the process of participating in the election itself can be an artistic process. So I've been always wondering whether Fai consider his own participation itself as an artistic process.
Actually, try to separate the two worlds. That you can tell from the leaflet that I have. Usually, when you are trying to promote yourself as an artist in the election, you should have your palette and the brush on your hand, and then there's a canvas behind you. But you can see from the leaflet, I just stand in front of some industrial building. This is a very clear statement for me that what I'm trying to see or what I'm trying to voice out from the whole process of the election, it's not only about the interests of a small group of people, which like, the artist group, but it's more about the public group.
But what I find interesting in terms of what your question to Fai was, and we spoke about when you ran for LegCo back in the day, I mean, what's interesting is that we talked about the object from a protest or the object from a movement moving into the museum. We talked about artworks that have political resonance once they're put into a certain constellation within a white cube. And then we actually have the artist body entering into the political space. So the space itself becomes transformative, right? Which goes back to what you were saying about if a political piece of art or a political gesture is predicated on being transformative, precisely because it sort of ruptures something for a conversation to happen that wouldn't necessarily happen. So in terms of like the spaces that we've moved through, then I thought it might be interesting. I guess we're going to pose this to Wen Yao and Cosmin. You know, we've gone from the museum to the White Cube to the city as a space, the political system as an infrastructure, like the institution, right, that an object finds itself in. So I'm like, Wen Yao, you said that you were very interested in the kind of relation between the relations you found when you were doing your Fulbright in the U.S. between the two contexts, Hong Kong and the U.S. And Cosmin, of course, you're a global curator, you know, and you've been through so many different contexts, and the show that you have in Parasites is also one that's really kind of moving through nation states and regions and sort of taking a very fluid approach to the idea of how politics is expressed. So I wonder if you guys can kind of reflect on that for a minute based on what you've heard in this conversation.
I think one thing that inspired me a lot, I mean, my experience in the state last year inspired me a lot, is that actually when I see all the wide range of activist art projects, actually they're not only talking about social politics like in Hong Kong. They touch on issues like gender, water issues, or racism, whatever you can name, actually you can find like gentrifications. A lot of projects actually are fantastic, and I've got very inspired is that actually they have very, the state, actually in the state I found they have very strong civil society, which is lacking in Hong Kong. I say that because, for example, like I started as a performance artist, and I have the label troublemaker. And I make troubles beautiful, hopefully, yeah, all the time. But then I have to stop and think, so then, what's up then? What can I do afterwards? So after I stir up all these troubles, can I offer a solution? And maybe the solution is not an immediate solution. So that's why the project I show you that I'm working on is actually I'm trying to make a stronger civil society by creating more like dialogues and critical discourse on Hong Kong. So it's not only like to think what I can do as an artist, but what we all can do together. That's how I feel.
Yeah, I mean, I won't necessarily mention something about my show, but rather about, you know, the fact that it's quite symptomatic that both Fai and Sampson have actually run for political office. It's symptomatic for the landscape in which we live in Hong Kong, in a way. And it shows several things. One thing that it shows is the analogy between the uncontrollability of both art processes and political processes, the fact that you know, both of them rely on different chains of negotiation and of with, you know, possible scenarios and possible outcomes, and in both cases what one can do is to, you know, give different impulses at different stages of the process and you know, conduct negotiation as good as possible and hope for the best. And it's interesting to see, you know, this coming together so closely, the, you know, an art project and an electoral, well, so to speak, political process being you know, associated in that way. I mean, the second show, the second thing that it reveals is the incredible, you know, fragility of the Hong Kong context in general, and, you know, the incredible malleability of the society in which we live, and the fact that, you know, it's still in many ways one of the most sui generis, one of the most atypical societies, you know, in the world, because of its incredible instability, you know. And if you want to be like metaphorical or poetic about it, you can say that yes, it resembles, you know, a canvas or you know, a field of art. But you know, and if we live here, we don't really want to do metaphors with about that. But it's a reality in a way of that defines Hong Kong?
I think the reality, it's inevitable that we have to talk about the election. And just to add a note that so besides Carrie Lam, there are two other candidates running for the election. So that's a former judge, Wu Kuo-hing, and a former financial secretary, John Zeng. And as we are speaking right now, and I think a lot of people were rushing to take pictures with David Beckham just now, but outside, at City Hall, I think tons of people are rushing to go take pictures with the other candidate, John Zeng. And while we were at the back at the waiting room, so we were talking about we were not talking about the election platform or anything, but we're talking about how they do the PR, the publicity, how John Zeng was being so successful with his PR campaign, and I think some of us had some comments on how his campaign actually got inspirations from art itself, and it actually helped him to engage with the public. Because now it's not just a PR campaign; it's more than it's not an art performance, but it's more than a PR campaign. And does political art matter? It might be in this case in Johnson's election. So, any thoughts? I think Wen Yao might have some interesting comments.
I think his campaign is so-called successful in the sense that actually he knows how to engage the people, even though you don't have a chance to vote, like because we have only 1,200 people in the committee who can vote for the chief executive. But then through his campaign, for example, the crowdfunding that he has done actually make an illusion to the people that you can contribute money, so you can be part of the campaign. But then somehow actually, I think he's clever in making things like this, but on the other hand, I'm very aware that actually he is sort of like absorbing all these tactics developed by the people to do all this like resistance or civil movement project and turn all these tactics into a political strategy. For me, I feel scared to see things like this. And I'm not sure if he win or not, if he's genuine or not. I can't tell after all these political campaigns. So yeah, I'm kind of like very
skeptical
about this.
What about you, Sampson? Some of his campaigns and inspired by art.
I think a lot of the campaigns are about forming community, forming a kind, a terminology I like to use is a temporary community or a coming community that I always like to use. But I think ultimately, Wen Yao, at the beginning of the talk, Wen Yao mentioned the term socially engaged art or social practice, which is all over the place in the art world in the past few years. I think what John Zeng employs in his techniques is actually inspired or partially about those techniques treasured by socially engaged practices that are about essentially about doing things differently on the one hand and working together differently of a community. I think to evaluate whether his practice is successful or whether there's any merits in his in terms of its aesthetics, I guess we have to talk about to what extent you form a new kinds of community.
I mean, this actually makes me think about a conversation we had here earlier about biennials, and Marco Rosso from DIS was here, who curated the 9th Berlin Biennial, and he's had this anecdote, and I'm gonna have to fact check myself, but he said that, I think it was the PR person of Angela Merkel, said that their favorite Berlin Biennial was Berlin Biennial 7 because it was the one when Arthur's, and I'm so bad with names, so it's Arthur's, could you say it in the microphone for me, please?
Zmiewski.
Yeah, that's the one. So that was their favorite because it was the one in which they invited Occupy, the, or an extension of the Occupy movement, to inhabit the KW Institute of Contemporary Art. And I think I'm really bad with it. The KW, the Kunstwerk. And Rosso, Marco Rosso said that it was really interesting because it was an example in which the government was able to see how institutions could absorb discontent, right? Which kind of brings us full circle back to the exhibition, Disobedient Objects, and the question that we, you know, the frame that we started with, actually. It's just a reflection, actually.
So, Faye, have anything to add?
Talking about engagement, I would say, as an artist, sometimes I feel powerless, while in some of the movement, the public was engaged and empowered. Let's take the umbrella movement as an example. For me, I was at the Occupy area, but I feel powerless that I can do no artwork about it. But at the same time, in that in the area, there are many creative activities happening in the area. Well, Sampson have a work of the projection of the different opinion or
oil machine.
Oil machine. But let me describe a picture for you. Like at the edge of the area, there is a we call them call him painter that he got a big canvas and he tried to paint what is happening in the area. But for me, it doesn't matter how, what's the painting. Actually, I didn't check anything on the canvas, but the canvas served as the roadblock of the area. And I always remember this this scenery that sometimes artists just involved in the movement as a common public, while the common public will have a very creative reaction when they are empowered and being engaged.
So do you feel that you as an artist has been challenged by all this creative practice, or what do you mean feeling powerless?
I didn't know what to do as an artist, but I know what to do as a general public at that time, at that moment.
I mean, that actually makes me want to ask Sampson and Wen Yao, when you guys were, you know, working to kind of document and preserve and the objects that were coming out of the movement, did you see yourselves as artists at the time, or was that just something else? You know, was it, did you separate the roles or not?
I think that's completely separated from the role as an artist, and there's a rather, as Wen Yao said, it's more like a civil society organization or a kind of initiative that is more about bottom-up collaborations rather than working as an artist.
I always position myself as an artist / researcher, so I can't split myself into the two different roles. And I think actually my research would support my artistic practice, and my artistic practice can kind of support my research work as well. So I don't see kind of how to divide it so clearly.
I mean, if I can add as an outsider to this question and as a curator, that actually, you know, for me, at least, like, this doesn't matter. Like, I'm completely, well, not completely, but it would be just as a footnote, interested in this question of, like, which role would they adopt and making a separation or trying to, you know, put a definition on this issue.
I mean, that, it's, because it's funny, because when...
I'm, you know, the question was fine, but it was an interesting issue.
But then this actually makes me think about when we were preparing for this talk, and you know, this whole notion of political art. I'm not sure if I'm comfortable with the term political. I mean, civil society I'm very interested in, because I think that relates more to the question of conversations and, you know, the idea of the commons, right, in which you have a space that has to be negotiated by many stakeholders. And so essentially, communication is essential for anything to get done. So, I mean, yeah, I'm with you on that, actually. But, I mean, it really depends, and that's what's so interesting, I guess.
I think we're running out of time, unfortunately. We would have taken questions, but I'm afraid we have to end it here. So, I guess, thank you very much for all the panelists, and thank you, everyone, for joining us here today. Thank you.